Alan, thanks for watching Proactive. EQTEC was up with its 2022 results recently. To discuss the progress the company made last year, I'm joined by Chief Financial Officer Nauman Babar, Chief Operating Officer Jeff Vander Linden, and Chief Technology Officer Yoel Alemán. Gents, good to speak with you all today.
Good afternoon.
Good to speak to you too. Good afternoon.
So, Nauman, let me start with you, because EQTEC has published those results with some indications of a weaker 2022 than the previous year. How should shareholders read this?
I think shareholders should read it that 2022 was a tough year for EQTEC, as is was for a lot of our competitors in the marketplace. But I think the critical thing to remember is that despite the difficulties in the market, EQTEC did deliver. Most importantly, we stuck to our strategy, and then we adapted the market conditions as we saw them. I think everybody understands that we are a post R&D pre EBITDA positive business. Where the team is really working quite hard on delivering the latter, and in the backdrop of significant market changes, we delivered, and there was a significant push despite capital constraints that we saw in Q1 of 2022. From a revenue perspective, we delivered a revenue of 8 million euros, which was less than what we had targeted, but more than our end of year guidance. This was less than the 9.2 million revenue that we recorded in 2021. However, we do understand that obviously because of the capital constraints in the market, there was less of capital that could be deployed to the projects, and we prioritized and we delivered accordingly.
Jeff, you seem to have put a lot of effort into market development centers as reference plants. Is Italy MDC now handed over? And what's your outlook for Croatia MDC and France MDC? Also, will there be other MDCs?
Yes. Look, as we've said all along, it is, the market development centers are the top of our list of priority projects, right? They're the ultimate attractors of interest from clients, from investors, and from potential partners. In fact, I was on a call only this morning with a major utility company who are looking to visit our Italy MDC, and we discussed arranging that for June. So we've already had on-site tours of the Italy MDC, and we expect more in the weeks and months to come. In terms of your specific questions on the status of the MDCs that we have, the Italy MDC, we are still doing handover. We're close, but it's not yet final. We did announce earlier in the year that we wanted this done and dusted by the end of March, which was perhaps a bit overzealous. But look, it's our first MDC, and it's already proving itself to be a very valuable showcase for us. We've exported electricity to the grid. We've produced biochar. We're pleased with the plant manager and the team we have there and the operations. And we're working very closely with the board of directors there to ensure the plant runs sustainably with minimal ongoing EQTEC technical intervention before we hand over and leave it to the local team. So it's very important to get that right. And we'll announce when the handover is completed. In terms of Croatia MDC, we announced again in our annual results, but we've announced earlier as well that last year, we already had a consortium of investors who were lined up to invest in the remainder of the work to be done in Croatia, in Belice at the plant. Unsurprisingly, they also want to visit the Italy MDC, and so we'll set up that visit very soon, perhaps again next month, so we can lock down the finance, commission the plant, and get it up and running with the industrial business model, which is what we're intended to do there. In terms of the France MDC, we engaged prospective buyers last year, and one of them has emerged as the favorite. They're a large French utility, and they've been great partners to work with so far. They visited the Italy MDC, and they told the feedback we had from them was that we exhausted their list of questions about the process of gasification and the risks associated. And so they were very impressed that our process engineering had considered absolutely everything about which they were concerned. So we're pushing forward now with those contracts, and we're still intending to finalize that in the first half of the year, by the end of June. However, the French government agencies, who have been supportive in principle, still have a bureaucracy to go through. And so there are critical approvals and handovers that need to be made as part of that process. And we just simply don't always get to control the timing of that. Finally, you asked about other MDCs. We've got the Italy MDC for agriculture, Croatia for industrial, France for utility. We may want one for municipal. We're always going to be up for more showcase plants, but I think as we evolve and as we make more go-to-market partners who are in fact large utilities and large industrials and large infrastructure investors, we will work with them. And we may see more and more pilot plants with new clients as our reference plant, I have to see.
Yoel, let's bring you in here. With all the efforts on deploying your technology, it seems you found time in 2022 for innovation. Is this truly an important focus for EQTEC right now?
Yes, definitely, of course. We always find time for innovation. I mean, it's the core of what we do, and that will keep us relevant in front of the market and also update whatever we do in terms of the alternative in front of other competitors. We did three main things in 2022 in the R&D area, let's say. One of them was the steam oxygen gasification, which was really important for us to prove that. So in order to achieve that goal, we upgrade the R&D facility we operate with our partners in Lermat in France. And we now have the capability to generate a syngas from different sources of feedstock that allow us to test that syngas in different type of application like synthetic natural gas, hydrogen separation, or any other chemical application. So that was a really important thing. We also did the test for contaminated plastics, which is important because this type of plastic materials contaminated with fossil fuel, let's say, in chemicals, in most of the European countries are not allowed to just incinerate or go into landfills. So it's becoming an important issue that our technology it's addressing properly, just to get rid of this as a residue or any other environmental impact. And that was a really important goal. We, at the same time we were doing that, we test also the facility with very high moisture content feedstock, which is also a key point here. Of course, that's for a different application. Is not like we described before with the steam oxygen, but even though very valid. And then the other thing what we did like in 2022 was just to test another RDF type of residue. In this case, it was also with a big mixture of different components. But the importance of this one particularly is that we are now getting involved in this type of R&D project because we have expressly the request of a client. So those tests give a response to a project opportunities. And that means that we are receiving real samples for the client feedstock just to be able to prove and test the solution that we are proposing to the client. I should mention also that in 2022, we exercised the collaboration framework agreement that we have in our partnership with Wood, their Vesta technology, which is important. Wood is supporting us in looking for the integrated solution of the whole concept, let's say, and we are appointing them in Southport, for example, in projects like Southport in Italy. They are collaborating with us also in a project in Italy and in the US. And then we also announced last year, and actually we continue with that with a company like Compact GTL, that they have a proven technology on oil and gas sector by doing fissile traps, obtaining liquid fuels from the syngas. And now we are trying to put together a pilot unit just to combine both technologies. And test the capability of both company on the integrated solution also. So it's important because the innovation and the technology partnership actions that we outlined give us a direct support on a specific project opportunities or pursuing or extending or platform of advanced biofuels of different type of feedstock, let's say. So it's important for us.
And Jeff, the annual report suggests you're delivering in line with your business strategy, but given the hardship of 2022, doesn't the strategy need to change?
Well, in terms of what the strategy is aiming to achieve, no. You know, we stated very clearly our business strategy and we are sticking to it. In terms of how we implement that strategy, yes, absolutely. And every year, every quarter, every month even, we have to adapt to the prevailing market conditions. We made mention in the annual report of the focus plan that we put in place in early 2022 in response to the capital markets, really the bottom falling out of the capital markets in light of what was happening in Ukraine with Russia and so on. And then the consequent knock-on impact of that in you know, the price of fossil fuels and so on. When we announced that focus plan, though, it wasn't a retreat. It was actually an acceleration of our business strategy, that business strategy aiming at moving us more quickly to becoming a technology licensor through doing some of the things that we've been outlining here. Yoel has pointed out, and I pointed out earlier, that our focus really results in our keeping key aspects of our strategy, such as the market development centers and innovation, at the forefront of our work. So if I just kind of remind us the three key aspects of the strategy that we're focused on, one is the demonstration through market development centers. You know, our technology is proven, but the market wants to see it operate in more places, more often across a wider range of business models. So I mentioned industrial business model for industrial clients. We have utility clients. We have municipalities and government clients. And then we have infrastructure investor type clients. And all of them are looking for slightly different applications of the same technology. We've got large scale project portfolio. I can talk about in terms of Billingham and Deeside and now Gardanne in France and some opportunities in Ireland that we haven't fully announced yet. We have a mid-sized portfolio in France and Italy and several municipalities. And then we have a small scale portfolio in places like California and Greece. But which business model, which configuration of the, you know, EQTEC technology operating in those environments will become the most demanded and kind of the sweet spot for us is something that we're quickly trying to discover and learn. So having the market development centers as our reference plans to pursue that discovery, you know, with clients is critical. The second element is our partner ecosystem. You know, we can't do this without great partners, you know, and Yoel has just mentioned a couple of very important technology partners. But we're also, you know, we're pivoting out of a legacy way of working, you know, toward that target model of technology licensor, but away from doing the whole value chain, which is what we were trying to do before. That was very expensive. It doesn't make best use of our core capabilities, and it made us rely on partners, some of whom were not always reliable. You know, so we can only make that progress, make that with world-class partners. So we're partnering with top developers, you know, with utility companies themselves. But now we've announced in Italy, the Colibri partners, you know, we've got announcements to follow in France. We're partnering with top technologies, as Yoel mentioned, Wood and Compact GTL, but also Energia. We've got announcements coming up for syngas to chemicals as well. We're partnering with top EPCs. You know, we've appointed Petrofac, we've appointed Black & Veatch, we've appointed Cosme, who we've worked with for many years, you know, with announcements to follow with others in other markets. And so as these partners take their expert roles in our value chain, they really empower us to focus on what we do best, which is the advanced process engineering and technology delivery for new energy infrastructure. And then finally, innovation is the third pillar, and really Yoel has articulated that better than I could. But just to finish out on this strategic pivot, you know, France, and we highlighted this in the annual report, France and to some extent Italy now are not encumbered by legacy contracts, legacy partners, or other legacy commitments. You know, they're relatively greenfield for us. And therefore, our business strategy is most evidently at work there, and we're making the fastest progress there. you know, with fully funded projects, top partnerships, and they really allow us to shine in terms of our capabilities. That pivot continues this year, and in fact, it's accelerating this year, and that will carry on until the momentum of growth takes over. You know, not only will that ecosystem of partners provide essential capability across the value chain, but they'll also start taking our technology to market, and we're already seeing that. You know, Wood is a technology partner, and yet we're having full pipeline discussions with them. The same is true of many of the other partners as well.
So how are things going so far for 2023, and what's your outlook for the rest of the year?
Well, as I mentioned, 2023 is starting well. You know, Nauman mentioned, you know, 2022 was by no means an easy year, but it was an absolutely formative year, and we couldn't be doing what we're doing in 2023 now without the hard work that was done in 2022. So in France, you know, we've already announced our selection for the Gardanne project. That's likely to be large-scale work. It's one of four projects that will replace an 850-megawatt electric capacity in the south of France. We've announced our joint win at Limoges with our partner IDEX, who are a very exciting company making the shift from incineration, decarbonizing, and building a wider set of business opportunities for them with our gasification technology. Both of those projects are focused on renewable natural gas. Both are funded. Both of us will see us working with top-tier partners. You know, that is our business strategy in action. And remember, we only launched EQTEC France in March 2022, just over a year ago. And now we have Italy with the Colibri project. Four projects already coming through a relationship with Wood and based on our engagement with the Italian developer Prometheus, right? Very experienced developer. And these projects put us with Wood as a single core provider of an integrated technology solution for renewable natural gas at the center of a consortium with Linde, Alfa Laval, and Chemprod. You know, and we're focused on those four projects with a view to future collaboration beyond that. So again, funded project, top-tier partners, new energy infrastructure. And we will go large again. You know, I mentioned earlier, you know, we're going to start looking back at Billingham. You know, the small-scale projects in California and Greece will tick along at whatever pace those markets need them to tick along at, right? But it's the MDCs we're going to push hardest. We've got a medium-scale work in France and Italy, and then we want to look again at the UK and France and Ireland where we see large-scale opportunities. We're still very committed to DSide, with Energia and other partners. You know, we're focused there on supporting Toyota's roadmap for carbon neutrality. And then at Billingham, you know, we've refashioned our approach there to support the industrial demand in Teesside for hydrogen. And other larger scale projects such as Gardanne are gonna benefit from that engineering work that, and the thinking we're doing there as well. And so the final thing I think that'll happen in 2023 is that we'll start to see gradually portfolios. I mean, I've already mentioned, you know, the four projects with Colibri. I've already mentioned we've got potentially, you know, another cluster of projects in Ireland that, you know, we hope now soon. But as we build these larger clients and these larger collaborations of partners, we're going to see portfolios of work that people are coming to us for. Pre-funded, top-tier partners and investors, and then multiple applications of EQTEC technology in different business models.
And in fact, our CEO, David Palumbo, is kind of following some of those opportunities out there. Hence, he could not make it to this video interview. One thing that I would like to point out here is as we move towards accelerating our business strategy to becoming a technology licensor, what we are seeing is a significant interest in both the size and stature of the clients and the partners who are approaching us. You know, one of the things which is a testament to EQTEC's technology and the profile that we're seeing right now is increased interest from investors, especially in the RNG and the biofuel space. And as you grow more towards going after these complex and bigger projects, obviously you would need a consortium of investors. So not a single investor would be stepping in. And EQTEC is obviously being at the forefront of the various applications that we've been talking about. We've been receiving a lot of interest. As part of that, we have also started a focused strategic project whereby we have retained a top-tier investment bank looking at the financing options to make sure that our company is best placed from a financing perspective to capitalize on these opportunities that are coming up, either it's in the RNG space or the biofuel space or any other for that matter. And I think just one more thing that I would like to focus is in 2022, as Jeff mentioned, there was a focus plan which literally had three tenets. You know, we focused on MDCs, made sure that Italy is completed, commissioned towards the tail end of 2022. We acquired and got approval for our finance France MDC. And then we engaged the Croatian investors and some other investors in the Croatia MDC to complete the construction of the project. The other elements were we negotiated deals which avoided 18 million euros worth of cost or potential capital exposure to EQTEC whilst maintaining access to our largest UK projects, which is Billingham, Deeside and Southport. And last but not the least is we always looked at ensuring that we the liquidity position of the business is reviewed, capital is deployed where it's most needed, and we keep in check the working capital and the operational expenditure elements of the business. We are going to continue to do the same in 2023 whilst deploying, as Jeff mentioned, our strategy in light of the current market conditions. So I think the way we look at it is, we're very hopeful in terms of the uptake and the interest that we see from the market for our technology and the projects going forward. And we're going to make sure that we keep the machine lean and we keep on delivering on innovation and technology.
I mean, it sounds like an exciting time for the company. Thank you all very much for your input today. So, that's Chief Financial Officer Nauman Babar, Chief Operating Officer Jeff Vander Linden, and Chief Technology Officer Yoel Alemán from EQTEC.